Being the node that has the most uses, you can use the Text Plus node to make practically any effect you can think of. When editing your own videos, whenever you've tried to make your own titles or lower thirds, you may notice there are actually two different types of text effects. Today we're just talking about the Text Plus. But if you want to see the other one, let me know down in the comments. To quickly summarize the difference, if you want the special characters like emojis, then use the regular text effect. But you won't be able to go into Fusion with it. If you want to go into Fusion and you don't really care about the other effects and you don't really care about emojis, then use the Text Plus node. There's also a lot more diversibility with the Text Plus node than the regular text effect. Welcome to an ongoing series on my channel where I try to teach you something quick and easy in DaVinci Resolve. Let's get to it. Before we start, I do want to actually thank you guys for the 100 subscribers. I haven't been able to mention it. I keep forgetting whenever I write these scripts. So I wanted to make sure I mention it here. Thank you all so much for 100 subscribers, and let's go for 100 more. All right, let's get to it. The typewriter effect is a really sought after effect for many editors, but many softwares make it a little too complicated to actually put it together. Sometimes it's an effect, sometimes it's like a hidden feature within the tool, but in Fusion, it's right on the base node. Come down here to write on your node, and you're able to just drag this in from the end, and you can see it reveals each character one by one. All you have to do is go to the start of your comp, set a keyframe, go about a second out, and move it out to the end, and you have a nice, fast type. But if, of course, you want to make it longer, you can always adjust where that last keyframe is, make it stretched out as long as you want. All right, that's all you need. All you have to do is put some sound effects on the edit page and you have yourself a really quick and easy typewriter effect. A question a lot of new Fusion editors ask is, how do I make my individual characters or words have special properties like different sizes, different fonts or underlines or colors? It's actually really easy to do, but it's hidden. Come up here to your text box and right click. This area where you'd usually see modifiers for any other control like size, you're gonna see a big old list of things that you're able to put onto this as a modifier. What you're looking for is character level styling. Click that and hop over here to modifiers. And now all you have to do is make sure that you can see your text by making it right on back to one. In the window over here, just select which text you want to modify and then it brings up all the correct controls. You can increase the size, you can select a different thing and you can make a different color. There we go. That's how you can make super unique and dynamic differences in your text without having to make different text nodes. A lot of streamers or YouTube editors often ask the question, how do I make a timer for my videos? Do a countdown or something. It's also really easy to do. Before we do that, though, we have to remove the character level styling from our box. Come down here after the right click and click remove character level styling. It'll just put our text back to default. What we're looking for is text code. I'll bring up text timer here at the very end because it's a little bit different. Text code is what we're looking for right now. So if you look, it just tracks how many seconds and frames this comp takes. So if we want to remove frames and hours, now we're just seeing minutes and seconds. So we can see that this frame is a total of 4 seconds. You can adjust the frames per second if you want this to go to like a different rate or whatever. You can also put an offset. We don't have to worry about any of these other things. But you may notice that this is counting up. What if you want to count down? Well, it's also pretty easy to do. Come into here on your edit page, right click your Fusion comp or your Text Plus effect from over here and make it a new compound clip and name it timer. And now you have your timer set to your length that you had it before. If you want to change how long you have it, open up in a timeline, make this as long as you need, and then back down here to go back to your timeline and you can make this as long as that clip is now. And then it will reflect it at the end. We want it to be about a 9-second timer, but it's still counting up. Come over here to speed change and click the reverse speed. Now it's going to count from the top number all the way down to the end. There you go. You made yourself a really quick and easy countdown. Before we move on, I do want to bring up the other tool that I mentioned. Let's go ahead and remove the time code. The other tool that I mentioned is a text timer. This is a different type of tool and more for use in the program to really track how long you take on something. So you can activate text timer and it has a few different presets. It's a countdown, timer, or a clock, which actually shows you current time. And you know, hours, minutes, days, months, years, really, really advanced and it's pretty accurate. It takes just your computer time. And you know, there's a timer so you can have like a stopwatch or a countdown, which as you can see, if you play through it, it doesn't actually change anything. You can't change it just by playing through your composition. But if you don't have it being played, you can just press start and it just starts the countdown or it starts timing up just automatically. And even if you play through, It doesn't speed it up, it doesn't stop it, it doesn't do anything. This tool is purely just to track how long you take to make something in the software. So up to you if you want to use this. It's just a really cool tool that I thought I'd mention too. Next up, we have the text scrambling effect, which is not as popular as the other effects I've mentioned, but it's still nice to know because it's great if you want to use this as a part of another title that you're making. All you have to do is once again, remove the previous modifier that we had on there and just find text scramble right above your timers. After you've done that, you can put in whatever sentence you want to up here. We'll just say this is my text, and you can add any substitute characters in here that you need. So if you want to put your other, you know, exclamation points, periods, hashtags, pound signs, whatever. And into here, you can add as many things as you want. Special characters aren't allowed, but anything that's a regular font, you can just add into there. And then if you want to just increase the randomness, you'll notice that it begins to randomize your text. If you play through it, it just shifts through a bunch of the different characters as it's playing. All you have to do is whenever you feel the need to go back to the original text, you just animate this as long as you want it to go back as slowly as you want. And now it'll just start out all scrambled, all mumbly, and then it'll slowly ease back into text. That's a really quick and easy way to do that. So you can turn off, don't change spaces, so it'll just add a bunch of stuff in the middle so it's all jumbled up so you can even tell what it's supposed to be. This is a really cool effect. It's really nice if you want to make a glitchy sort of text effect animation for your title. It's up to you once again. I think it's really cool and I definitely want to use this in future projects. Finally, one of the last modifiers we're actually going to talk about at all is the follower modifier. This is maybe the most popular and most used out of any of the modifiers we've talked about so far. This allows you to do individual character animations or word animations to your text with barely any effort. All you have to do is right click once again and go over here to follower, come up to modifiers again, and we are immediately met with a confusing menu. You can really ignore the first one because this one's not super important unless you like are experienced, played with it some, and know what effect you're going for. We can go ahead and change order to left to right. It's going to default to that automatically, but it's nice to like look at this and see what other options we have, you know, just to keep them in mind. You can keep delay type to between each character, so the delay is in frames. You can also do partial frames if you really want to. Obviously, you can tell by delay type how it's calculating what it's doing. Between each character, after the first animation starts, how soon after that will the other animation start for the next character. Between first and last character, in between the first and last characters, how many frames do you want it to last? So if we set this to say 5, and we come over here to shading and look at the opacity, and if we mess with the opacity, nothing's happening. Oh no, did we do something wrong? All you have to do is animate this, and as soon as you animate it, you're able to adjust the slider. It just doesn't look for any changes until it begins the animation because that's kind of what it's built for. But keep in mind, you don't actually have to animate the control to change something. You can also add a modifier, and as long as this little icon is red, you have the ability to change that slider. Something important to keep in mind, because you can use anim curves, and it will actually eliminate the need for any keyframe. So let's go ahead and set this to 0, and then set this over here to maybe, I don't know, 40. No, let's do 24, and we'll set this back up to 1. If we play through it, it's a very slow, very gradual fade in. Because we have 5 frames after the start of that first animation. At the 5th frame, we have the H starting to come in. Very faintly, you can see it coming in there. And then in another 5 frames, we have the I. And so, after 24 frames, the T is finished animating, and the H finishes animating, and so on. So it's a very slow, very gradual effect, and you can really make anything with this. Really cool, really handy, and you can combine anything that we're about to talk about with this and make a really cool effect. You can even do word-by-word animation. Sometimes text doesn't fit in a perfect line, and you need to actually have it curved like the old word art from Word from Microsoft a couple years ago. Over here to layout, all you have to do is drop down this type all the way down here to path. Now you're able to either connect it to a previously existing path or write your own. Before we actually write our own, let's go ahead and right click and remove text one path. This makes sure that if we move our cursor, it won't accidentally create another keyframe and accidentally make the shape kind of shift. So if we go ahead and make a point here and make a point roughly right across right around here, we can see that our text will just snap to that line. Now if we select this little cursor icon with a plus, it'll allow us to go into the insert and modify. We can insert a point and, you know, move it however we want, and we can also select a point and adjust their handle. So we can bring this one up a little bit, select this one and bring it up around about the same amount, and we can just make a nice gradual arc. And there we go, we have nice arced text. On top of the arced text, we also have the ability to change the position along the path, including going off the path so we can come up from off screen and then animate onto the path and animate off the side. it's really easy to do that. And you can, of course, then add your curves in your spline panel, whatever you want to do. It's really freaking cool, really fast, really simple. During the follower section, I did mention that you're able to do word-by-word animation with that modifier. Well, you're able to do word-by-word editing using the base version of the node, but then go into the modifier and you're able to animate it individually with the delay. Let me show you how to actually do the word-by-word editing first. Come over here to your Transform tab on your text. Come down here to Transform and change it from characters to words. Now you're editing on the word scale. So if we come over down here to Size and right-click Expression and connect it to your X, just so you can make sure that those two are connected. Make it bigger, and you can see we're editing based off of like the center bottom of the text. And you're able to adjust the pivot a little bit, so you're not just editing off of that. You can edit more on the middle as well. So you can make it really simple, just like that. So there you go. That's how you can do word individual editing, and combine that with the follower modifier, and you can get like text popping in. You can combine any of these things and make some really cool text animations. I can't wait to see what you guys make. On the same tab right here, the transform tab, we also have shear, which isn't as important. Let me just say right now, it's not as important as the rest of the things I've showed you, but it is still a really cool tool that I think is really good to have on hand. You're able to shear your text however you really need, you know, in any of the directions. And if you're on character level like this, you can do some really crazy stuff like this right here, putting it on its side, making it look really funky and wonky. Just some really cool stuff. Not as much to really talk about, but there's shear. Now for the big one, the shading tab. If you've opened up the Text Plus node before, you've gone into shading and you've seen all of these different elements and you've been like, what is going on? What do I do? What does all this mean? Don't worry. Text styling is very important to making your text stand out as yours. But keep in mind, there is such thing is too much styling, and with 8 different elements of styling, that can be very easy to do. So let me show you what each of them can do, and let's break down maybe the best way to make your own text styles. So first off, we have the first text element. This generally is the base version of your text. If you change the appearance to be this little sort of outline effect, it'll give you a cool little outline. You can change the thickness, and this may be what you're going for. It's already pretty cool, but generally we'll just keep it as this. So let's go ahead and keep it right there, make sure this is white again, and set this back down to 0. Let's check out the number 2 of the text elements, which is default called the red outline. We can turn it on and we can change all sorts of different settings. We can make it thicker. And if you look, it's using that effect that we just used, but it looks like it's maybe layered on the outside, like maybe it's layered above it because we can see it, right? It's visible. It's designed to where if we go back to the first text element and we disable red, turn this back on to this and make this really thick, we can see it fills in the inside. So if we put that in our head and make it over here to the red text outline and bump this all the way up, we can see it does not fill the inside, which tells you what? It's layered beneath it. So everything from 1 down to 8 is different layers of the text effect. So layer 1 is the topmost effect. And then as you get higher in numbers, the more behind each layer it is. But you can see it does a bunch of different crazy things, and you're able to do offset and you're able to do all sorts of stuff, you know, change the size. Pretty nifty. At last, we reach the godsend 3D text. This is what everybody wants to end up using. This is what everybody ends up thinking of when they think, okay, how do I make a really cool text element? Either track it or make it 3D. Well, let's show you how to make it 3D. But we don't actually need this node, so we need a different setup entirely. One sec. All right, I've just set up a really quick and easy 3D environment. If you don't know how to do this, check out a future video tagged up here and above in the icon going over how to use the 3D environment and how to set this up as I'm doing it here. All I've done is I've made a 3D camera, moved it back some, and set the target to be round what the text is. So if you move the camera around, it's just gonna keep that text centered. And I also have a spotlight in here so I can move it back, move it over, and angle it. And if we were to come into here to render 3D and enable lighting and shadows, easy enough. If we were to move our camera around again, we can see our text is looking kind of flat. How do we make it thick? All you have to do is come down here to extrusion on your main text tab and just increase the extrusion depth. And if you can see, we're just getting thicker and thicker as we go. Then if we increase the bevel width and bevel depth, we can see we can get a different sort of flattened edge effect. So it's not so sharp. We can disable flattening buffling the back since we won't be able to see that. If we come over here to our shading tab, we'll notice a huge difference. We don't have all the different shading elements, which kind of stinks, and I wonder if that's not meant to be that way. But we're able to change the color and specular exponents on the text so we can make it look however we need. All we have to really do now to make a interesting sort of text effect is come over here and set this back over to in front of our text. We can actually make this the first frame and then come back over here to maybe frame 100, center it back up roughly, and there we go. You're now a master of the Text Plus node. But do you know how to make that 3D environment that I just showed off? If not, watch this video and follow along, making the same sort of environment right here.